last lecture, I tried to give a some kind of overview of the experimental situation concerning the complex of effects which usually go under the name of supersolidity in solid helium 4. And I put a fair amount of emphasis on torsional oscillator experiments. I should mention that there is one group of experiments which I didn't review, which is by the Kubota group at ISSP in Tokyo. They appear to get results which are rather different from those of the Cornell group, but in particular with regard to the dependence of the effect on the rotational velocity. Their analysis is very specifically in terms of the so-called vortex fluid model of Anderson, which I'll try to refer to briefly later on. I simply haven't had time to compare in detail those results with the Cornell group, but I think that is an important issue as to what's going on there. So one should bear in mind that, as always in a rapidly developing field, the experiments are not always obviously mutually consistent. I'm afraid this lecture is going to be perhaps slightly disorganized because it's partly cannibalized from various other talks. I hope it'll make a certain amount of sense nevertheless. So let's try to think a little about what's going on in these so-called supersolid experiments. Really, I think there are various hypotheses that have been put forward in the literature. The most, in some sense, the most conservative and perhaps disappointing interpretation is that the effects are simply nothing really to do with superfluidity or anything related to it, but purely a result of torsional stiffening. That, of course, would in itself be quite an interesting phenomenon. I mean, why does the torsional stiffening occur, and so on, but it wouldn't have much to do with superfluidity. Second possibility is that what's being seen is anomalous kinetics, that is, it's not a genuine thermal equilibrium phenomenon, but rather the failure of the system to come into equilibrium sufficiently fast. That might be due to impurities such as dislocations and so forth, or it could be perhaps something which occurs in the perfect crystal. Finally, there is the possibility that what we're seeing is genuine supersolidity. That is something which has at least qualitatively a lot in common with the superfluidity of liquid helium 4. Again, that could be due either to dislocations, grain boundaries, etc., or it could be due to the perfect crystal. Now, I think of these various possibilities, by far the most exciting from a theoretical point of view is 3B. That is, you have genuine supersolidity due to a perfect crystal, and therefore I'm going to spend a fairly large portion of this lecture talking about that issue. But let's first of all say a little about some of the other possibilities. Okay, as to the torsional stiffening, we did talk about this a little in the last time. You recall that the angular frequency of a torsional oscillator is the square root of two factors, the torsion constant divided by the moment of inertia. Now, what we observe, at least what was observed in the original Penn State experiments on supersolidity, was an increase in omega. That was has mostly been interpreted as due to a decrease in the moment of inertia. However, that of course is only correct if we assume that k is unchanged. So, what happens if we assume that the change is in k and not in I? Why should we do that? Why should k change, the torsion constant? Well, in most torsional oscillator geometries, the solid helium 4, either in the fill line or in the bulk, plays it does play a role, a small role, in the torsion constant, and the contribution to the torsion constant should be proportional to the shear modulus of solid helium 4. Now, as we said last time, this shear modulus is something that you can measure independently, and we do know that it shows an anomaly which appears to attract, I think most people agree that it tracks the temperature dependence of the so-called NCRIF fraction, F. Let me just remind you, the NCRIF fraction, which I'll usually denote F, is essentially the fraction of the liquid, which if you interpret the experiments, the torsional oscillator experiments, in terms of supersolidity, it's that fraction which appears to be behaving in like a superfluid. In other words, it does not follow the motion of the container. And as I say, we know that mu tracks its temperature dependence, and at least in some of the experiments, it appears to track the velocity dependence of this fraction. So it does seem a plausible hypothesis that maybe what's being seen here is not a decrease in I, but rather an increase in K. However, I think there are some fairly strong arguments against that hypothesis. Perhaps the strongest is that if this really were what was going on, then you should expect it to occur for any substance with which you fill your cell, which shows the anomaly in the shear modulus. And in fact, solid helium-3 does show similar anomalies in its shear modulus. However, there's nothing, no frequency shift, no apparent change in the rotational properties. Secondly, it appears that this is fairly recent experiments. If you impose a DC rotation, or perhaps flow is wrong, it's really a DC rotation, then that appears to affect the NCRIF fraction, but not the shear modulus. Furthermore, in some of the experiments, the quantitative value of the NCRIF fraction is too large to be explained by the known anomaly in mu. People did have actually designed experiments specifically to test this point by making sure that any effect of mu in their particular geometry would be rather small. They nevertheless found a fair anomaly in F. Again, for helium-4 in Vicor, it looks as if the effect is too large to be explained by this. The effect of the shear modulus in Vicor should be much less than it is in the bulk. And finally, other experiments actually show different velocity dependencies of mu and of F. So the situation is complicated. There's a recent paper which, a couple of months ago actually, which was devoted essentially entirely to this point. And they review the various experiments and conclude, I think it's fair to summarize their conclusions as saying that while certainly in some experiments the observed frequency shift may be a consequence of the torsional stiffening, in most of them it really doesn't appear to be. So what this would suggest is that while it's very striking that the shear modulus follows the NCRIF fraction, in some sense that it looks as if they're probably both consequences of some common cause. Okay, let me just stop for a moment and ask if there are any comments or questions on that. Okay, so it looks then as if this, in some sense, most boring possibility is not really consistent with the experiments. Okay, the next possibility is that what we're seeing is actually anomalous kinetics. The basic point here is that the torsional oscillator experiments essentially by definition have to be at non-zero frequency, and in almost all the experiments to date the frequency in question has been somewhere of the order of a kilohertz or so. And so the question is, could the effect be simply a failure to come into equilibrium with the rotating walls on a time scale of the order of a millisecond, the period of this oscillation? And this such a failure could have nothing to do with superfluidity. For example, it could conceivably be a consequence of the fact that for one reason or another, the contact of the system with the solid walls is somehow changed in these temperatures. There are, I think, some arguments in favour of that hypothesis. There was one experiment which deliberately looked at the frequency dependence of the NCRIF fraction. They had two oscillation modes, different frequencies, 500 and 1200 hertz. Now, what they found was that the zero temperature value of F was essentially the same for these two. However, for higher temperatures, F of T was larger for the higher frequency mode, but somewhat puzzlingly, the dissipation peak was lower for those. So that suggests that at least the frequency of the torsional oscillator does have some role to play in these phenomena, the non-zero frequency. Incidentally, one thing which this experiment also established, I think fairly satisfactorily, was that indeed the critical quantity, the quantity which controls the magnitude of the effect, is the velocity, the rim velocity, and not the angular amplitude or acceleration. They could verify this by comparing the results at these two different frequencies. A second argument in favour of anomalous kinetics is the absence of pressure-induced flow through a capillary. However, there are also, there are also a number of arguments against the hypothesis that it's anomalous kinetics. I think the strongest of which is probably the block capillary effect. Remember that when you actually take your annular geometry and block it off by putting a plug, then the effect goes away. Now, if it were simply anomalous kinetics, then it seems a little difficult to understand why that would be so. It's not impossible, but it looks less plausible that it should be so there. Second argument against, I think, is the non-trivial effect of DC rotation. Again, if it were simply anomalous kinetics, say some kind of vanishing contact with the walls and so forth, there seems no obvious reason why it would be affected by DC rotation. Furthermore, there are experiments which are essentially DC experiments where you get a particle transport from the liquid through the solid back into the liquid. We discussed those last time. And finally, there is an anomaly in the specific heat which is at least suggestive that what you're seeing here is some kind of thermodynamic equilibrium phenomenon and not just a transport anomaly. Again, these arguments are perhaps suggestive rather than totally compelling, but they do carry, I think, some weight. Now, there is one very obvious way of testing whether indeed all that you're seeing is anomalous kinetics, and that would be a repeat of the so-called Hess-Fairbank experiment, which remember was done in solid helium-3. Remember the Hess-Fairbank experiment is the one in which you start off with a bucket of liquid above the lambda transition, you rotate it slowly, and while continuing to rotate the bucket slowly, you cool the liquid down, and lo and behold, the liquid comes out of equilibrium with the rotating bucket. Okay, now, if you could repeat that experiment for the solid, and the solid would behave in the same way, then I think that would be definitively refute the hypothesis that it's simply anomalous kinetics, and vice versa. However, unfortunately, because of, among other things, because of the very small value of F, appears to be a very difficult experiment. I mean, the original Hess-Fairbank experiment in the liquid was not at all trivial. It's going to be orders of magnitude more difficult for the solid. So unfortunately, although this is something which I think all the experimental groups would like to do, it doesn't appear to be likely to happen in the near future. Okay. Now let's go on. Before I go on, let me just ask whether there are any questions or comments on this. So I probably haven't done justice to this possibility because, as I say, I wanted to talk more about, if you like, genuine supersolidity. But I think it's a very, very real question. Yep.
Can you remind us of the geometry of the container that you put the plug in to stop the...
Yeah, So it's basically just a simple annular geometry, like so, and you basically put the plug across here. So you've interrupted the multiple connectivity of the geometry. Okay, now I'm going to go on to talk about genuine supersolidity, but before I do so, let me just spend a little time talking about our understanding of superfluidity in liquid helium-4, where I think most people think we have it under rather good control. As I guess I mentioned last time, there are two major manifestations of superfluidity in liquid helium-4. As always, we'll define a characteristic quantum unit of rotation, h bar over mr squared. Then, first of all, so if we put it in this geometry here, first of all, we have the Hess-Fairbank effect in which we rotate the container very slowly and cool down through the lambda temperature. And the observation is that part of the liquid appears to come to rest. Perhaps I don't actually say come to rest, rather remains at rest. As we cool down, the liquid comes to rest in the laboratory frame. And in fact, when we go down to zero temperature, it looks as if 100% of the liquid has come to rest in the laboratory frame. I've got the question mark there because of this delicate point that I mentioned last time, that in fact, we believe theoretically that it actually comes to rest in the frame of the fixed stars, and there is some experimental evidence in favor of that. Now, important to realize, this genuinely is a thermodynamic equilibrium effect. It's the analog of the diamagnetism of a superconductor which underlies the Meissner effect. The second major manifestation of superfluidity in the liquid is the stability of supercurrents. For this, you need the container to be stationary and the liquid to be rotating, but fast compared to this characteristic unit. It's rather plausible, and in fact one can prove rigorously, a special case of something I'll prove later, that the equilibrium state of the liquid is at rest, but the observation is that the liquid continues to rotate indefinitely. As long as you keep it below the lambda temperature. You can go up and down in temperature and the amount of rotation will increase or decrease, but the qualitative factor of rotation will persist as long as you want to watch it. That's a metastable effect. It's the analog of persistent currents in superconductors. Now, there's an interesting question whether these two phenomena, the Hess-Fairbank effect and metastable supercurrents, inevitably go together. Well, I don't think we really have much experimental evidence on this, but at least in theory, they certainly don't. First of all, could you get metastable supercurrents without the Hess-Fairbank effect? Well, certainly, in a rather trivial way. If you have an exactly cylindrical C-number container, then the angular momentum is rigorously conserved. So certainly, you'd get it under those conditions, although it wouldn't look quite the same as what it does in real liquid helium. A more interesting question is whether you can get A without B. That is, whether the Hess-Fairbank effect necessarily implies metastability of supercurrents. And it certainly doesn't. The best known counterexample is the non-interacting Bose gas, which certainly shows the Hess-Fairbank effect, certainly does not show metastability. A more subtle and interesting case is the spinner half Bose system. This is not widely known, I think, but once you allow an internal degree of freedom, like a spin which can orient itself in arbitrary directions, then you find you still get the Hess-Fairbank effect, but circulating supercurrents are no longer metastable, and they can decay. So these two phenomena are not conceptually identical at all. Yeah?
Is there any upper limits on the frequency of the rotation of the supercurrent?
Yes. You mean in real liquid helium? Theoretically, yes. One would expect the metastability to break down when the rotational velocity becomes comparable to the speed of sound, say. As far as I know, there are, for practical reasons, there are no experiments on that. This is, incidentally, a question which becomes very interesting in the context of the ultra-cold alkali gases, where one may be able to rotate the container in such a way. Incidentally, the question of whether you have an exact analogue of the upper critical field of superconductors in liquid helium is a nasty one. My colleague Gordon Baim has thought a bit about that. And it's a tricky question. Let me just very briefly run through the textbook explanation of superfluidity in liquid helium 4. The order parameter, which we'll define later in a bit more detail, let's assume for the moment we have an order parameter, and it's supposed to be a complex scalar. So it has a modulus and a phase, and we define the superfluid velocity as a constant times the gradient of the phase, and assume that under thermodynamic equilibrium conditions, for given Vs, as we'll see later, we can have thermodynamic equilibrium or metastable equilibrium in which Vs is not zero. And in such conditions, the superfluid current is the superfluid density times the superfluid velocity. We assume that for T less than Tc, the magnitude of our order parameter is pinned close to some appropriate non-equilibrium value, psi zero, by energetic considerations, and it takes a lot of energy to distort it much from that equilibrium value. Now, when the walls are stationary, the system is going to minimize the Hamiltonian, subject to the so-called single valueless boundary condition, which I'll come back to later. This is going to play a very important role in the general analysis. The single valueless boundary condition basically says that if I take one particle around the ring and bring it back to itself, while for the moment at least keeping the others fixed, I must come back to the same value. So we'll discuss that in more detail later. When the walls rotate with an angular velocity omega, then it turns out, again, I'll discuss this more later, you have to minimize H with a modified single valueless boundary condition. This costs an energy a omega squared, and it then turns out that rho S, the superfluid density, is proportional to this coefficient of omega squared. So crudely speaking, I think we can put this in actually a rather simpler way. In fact, I wonder whether at this point I should just skip on briefly to a later. Let me just skip very briefly to something which I do later. I think there we had it. Did we? Yes. This is really, a discussion which refers to the liquid. The phase of one's order parameter, forget the supersolidity for a moment, let's just talk about the liquid. The phase of the order parameter must be single-valued modulo 2 pi. So all you can have is an S state, a P state, or whatever. So the angular kinetic energy of the condensate is given by the value of L0, which applies to the condensate, times various factors, as here. Now, what is this value L0? That is the condensate an S state, a P state, or what? Well, when the walls are at rest, fairly clearly it's in an S state. So the angular momentum is zero. When the walls rotate, the prescription for doing your statistical mechanics is that you replace H by H0 minus omega to L. That means the effective kinetic energy of the condensate is this. Now, if you stare at that expression, you see that for small enough omega, that is going to be minimized by having L0 equal to zero. However, if I go to a large enough value of omega, I find that it becomes energetically advantageous for the condensate to jump into the P state here, and then eventually into the D state, etc., etc. So this does give you at least qualitatively the argument as to why you get a Hess-Fairbank effect, because you see that the sufficiently small omega here, the angular momentum, as viewed from the lab frame, is zero. In other words, the condensate, and at zero temperature that means the liquid as a whole, is not following the rotation of the walls. The angular momentum is still zero in the lab frame. So that then is the, very crudely and qualitatively, is the explanation of the Hess-Fairbank effect in the case of the liquid. I should just comment that although you get the jumps correctly, you get the way that the system jumps from one state to another correctly by this argument, you don't get the value of rho s right. If this argument were right, were completely as it stands, then the angular momentum should be the condensate number, not the total number. Whereas in fact at zero temperature, we know in real liquid helium the condensate number is only something like 10% of the total number. The superfluid density nevertheless is 100%. And that's, crudely speaking, that's because the condensate drags the normal, the uncondensed particles with it. One other amusing point about this, which is not often noticed, is that when I'm, say, here, this value of angular velocity, the liquid is actually rotating faster than the container. Rather peculiar. Okay, so that's the, that very crudely is the explanation of the Hess-Fairbank effect, at least qualitatively, in the case of the liquid. So any questions before I go on? Yep.
Well, I wonder why the energy is split in a discrete.
Why the energy spectrum is discrete. That's a very, very good point indeed. Well, if you had a single particle, you see, the angular momentum would be quantized, and therefore the energy would have these discrete values. Now, the point is that by the definition of Bose condensation, all your particles must be, all your condensed particles have to be in the same one particle state. Yes, that's, thank you for raising that point, it's very important. You are using here the fact, very, very crucially, the fact that by definition of Bose condensation, all the condensed particles have to be in the same one particle state. And therefore, you get this quantization.
Because I saw that like, you mentioned about H and when you back into like...
I'm sorry?
When you are back into effective frame, you said it's like, somewhat proportional to omega.
Yes.
So I thought like the energy splitting should be like continuous.
If the if you were talking about the normal liquid, then you would find that to a very high degree of approximation, the angular momentum would be linearly proportional to omega. Yeah, but for the condensed the superfluid phase, it's not. Okay, good. So let's just go back now to.
Are these particles considered electrically neutral?
The helium. Yeah, helium particles. Well, yes, usually they are.
Is there any non-neutral superfluid?
From a modern point of view, the phenomenon of superconductivity is really simply superfluidity occurring in a charged system. I mean, you can analyze the behavior of superconductors in very much the same way as you do that of neutral superfluids. However, the long-range Ampere effects mean that it looks very different. But yeah, I mean, in effect, any superconductor is a charged superfluid. Yeah, but at least at the sort of level we're talking about, liquid helium really is composed of very, very neutral atoms. Okay. So we want to. Yeah. The second phenomenon is actually, in some sense, a little easier to understand. That is the phenomenon of persistent currents. You remember that this is a case in which we have our walls at rest, but the liquid is actually rotating. There's a finite. Circulating current here. Remember that in metastable thermodynamic equilibrium, the current is proportional to the superfluid velocity. So it's proportional in this case to the integral of the superfluid velocity around the circuit. That's equal to the that's proportional. Remember, Vs is proportional to grad phi. So that's proportional to this quantity here, which is the so-called winding number. Imagine, I think an analogy which is useful to visualize this situation is that you have a hula hoop around your waist, you tie a string around the, wind it around the hula hoop and then tie the ends back together again. Okay, so the angle of the string is meant to represent the phase of the superfluid condensate in this example. Now, you can easily convince yourself, you can actually do this experiment if you care to, it's a very, very trivial experiment. You can shuffle that string backwards and forwards as much as you like, but unless you actually cut the string or cut the hula hoop, one thing you're never going to be able to change is the number of turns you make going once around. Okay? So that's the so-called winding number. So the analog of that statement is that as long as the magnitude of the order parameter is greater than zero, then the winding number is topologically conserved. That in turn means that JS, the circulating superfluid current, is conserved over astronomical timescales. And that's the sort of standard explanation of metastability of supercurrents, which has been given for many years now in the case of liquid helium 4. Any questions or comments on that?
There's another question about angular momentum conservation.
Ah, okay, good point. I think, generally speaking, it's whether you're discussing liquid helium or you're discussing ultra-cold atomic gases or whatever, it's important to distinguish carefully between those arguments which are based entirely on energetics and those which also involve considerations about the kinetics, that is, the rate at which certain processes happen. Now, this argument was essentially based entirely on energetics, did not refer to the kinetics at all. Suppose that you have a very smooth annulus, say, and let's say somehow you switch off the phonons in the walls, etc. Then, as we've seen previously, even in the absence of superfluidity, you could get persistent current simply for the trivial reason that angular momentum is conserved. Now, in real life, we, at least in the case of liquid helium, we always assume that there are going to be enough rugosities in the walls, enough phonons, etc., that angular momentum is not rigorously conserved. So it may take some time for this, so if the system is not superfluid, it may take it some time to decay, but it will decay.
It was kind of actually with reference to the previous bit when you these jumps.
Oh, yes. Mm. Ah, good, good. Okay, so. That's an interesting question. I've got this liquid above TC, say, which has a non-zero angular momentum, and now when I cool it down, it's supposed to go to a state where it has zero angular momentum. Where does the angular momentum go to? The answer is it goes into the rotation of the bucket, in fact. And that is how Hess and Fairbank originally detected the effect in their experiment.
One final one there. So you've got it spinning, so it's got zero angular momentum. And then you gradually increase it just a tiny bit, and suddenly it has to jump an angular momentum.
You're thinking of an experiment in which we actually fix temperature and change the rotational velocity.
Yeah, very slowly, just above suddenly the rotation of the bucket presumably has to slow down dramatically to compensate the
suddenly speeding up. In the case of helium, I don't think Hess. There are very few experiments, in fact, of the Hess-Fairbank nature in helium. Certainly Hess and Fairbank, I think, never did that particular branch of experiment. In the case of alkali gases, I guess people have done similar experiments. And I'm just trying to remember, I don't remember offhand the results, but I'm fairly sure that what happened was that you did not get a sudden jump. I mean, it relaxed over a finite time scale. Okay. I think we should be careful here. I've always myself, in my original paper way back in 1970 and ever since, used NCRI to mean the Hess-Fairbank effect. However, in the recent literature, it seems to have been used in a much wider sense. So perhaps we should just cancel that line, in fact. Assuming that we do the Hess-Fairbank effect, then there are two rigorous theorems on the superfluid density. First of all, if the Hamiltonian of your system is invariant under both spatial translation and time reversal, and neither is spontaneously broken in the ground state, then at zero temperature, the superfluid density is the total density. There are a couple of arguments one can give for that, which I won't go through in detail because I'm running out of time if I do. One of them is a sort of thermodynamic argument, which is, to my mind, a bit sort of wonky, and the other is a more rigorous argument, which I actually gave in this paper in 1998. This leaves open the question whether any Bose system, which is liquid at t equals zero, necessarily has to be a superfluid. I suspect the answer is yes, but it's not easy to prove, actually. You can prove it, and in fact, there was a very nice paper by Gavare and Nozier way, way back in the 60s, which did actually prove this to be the case, provided that you could use perturbation theory. However, if you can't use perturbation theory, all bets are off. Second point, and this will be important for further considerations on the supersolid. Irrespective of the translation invariance of the Hamiltonian, if the density, the mean particle density, is itself varying as a function of the relevant direction, then you have this upper limit on the superfluid density. And crudely speaking, the interpretation of that is, you can see the interpretation of that by looking at the case of a non-interacting Bose gas in a periodic potential. You want to basically modify your phase to fit the boundary conditions, so you have to put kinks in it. However, if there are regions where the wave function is, it's an obvious which is which here. The black line, I guess, here is supposed to be the potential, and the green line is the amplitude of the wave function. So when the potential is high, the amplitude of the wave function is low, and you can actually put your phase kinks in there at the expense of very little energy. That's what gives you this limit on the superfluid density. That was my original paper in 1970. That, however, has been widely misunderstood. It really is only an upper limit on the superfluid density. It does not say that the system has any superfluid density at all. It may or may not, but if it does, then that's an upper limit on it. Okay. Very briefly, I think, again, I'm going to have to speed up a little here. How do we relate the concept of off-diagonal long-range order to superfluidity? Well, it's basically a generalization of the argument I gave previously. Define our one particle density matrix at zero temperature in this standard way. So basically, you take the many-body wave function with particle 1 at position R1 and all the others at given positions. Take it again with all the others at similar positions but having moved R1 to R'1. And that then integrate over all the other particles, that gives you your rho 1. So rho 1 is clearly, in some sense, a measure of the single particle behavior averaged over the behavior of all the other n minus 1 particles. Now you can always, because of the Hermitian nature of this quantity, you can always express it in a canonical form in terms of a set of eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. And we say we have BEC, Bose-Einstein condensation, if one and only one of the NIs is of order N and not of order 1, all the rest of order 1. In that case, for when R minus R prime goes to infinity, then rho 1 loses all the other components and you're just left with the special one, so-called condensate. And so we can actually define our order parameter in this way. We define an order parameter by psi of 0, psi of R, is this special wave function, the so-called condensate wave function. This is a single particle wave function into which you've got condensation. N0 here is the number of particles which are condensed into that wave function. And this is a perfectly good definition of the order parameter. Let me emphasize that, because if you read many textbooks and review articles, they'll give you some nonsense about spontaneous breaking of U1 symmetry, etc., etc. You don't need any of that stuff. I will talk about that in a later lecture, but for now, it's enough to note that you don't need any of this nonsense about particle number being not conserved or anything of the kind to define your order parameter and to get all the phenomena of superfluidity. This does a perfectly good job. So again, this is a generalization of what we did previously. We write psi is a e to the I phi, vs of r, etc., etc. When viewed from the rotating frame, the single-valued boundary condition gives rise to the Hess-Fairbank effect. So, barring pathology, we can say that BEC is a sufficient condition for superfluidity. So what this means is that if we can demonstrate the possibility of BEC, for example, for solid helium 4, then theoretically at least we will have demonstrated the possibility of real superfluidity in that system. Okay? So hopefully that's clear. Okay, so now let's ask, can we get BEC in a real solid? And again, there are two obvious possibilities. We might get some kind of superfluidity due to defects. The reason is that close to a defect, the structure of the system is really not that of the bulk solid. And you could imagine that atoms are much freer to move, for example, along a grain boundary or along a dislocation than they would be in the bulk. And there has been a fair amount of work along those lines, and there's a fairly nice review of it by Bonsignani and Prokofiev very recently in Reviews of Modern Physics here. The favoured candidate turns out, for all sorts of technical reasons I won't go into, to be a screw dislocation along the C axis. Numerical calculations give a one-dimensional superfluid density. Remember, that has to have the units of inverse length, so it's an inverse angstrom, which would correspond to a superfluid tube of diameter around 6 angstrom. So the, yeah.
What exactly is a screw dislocation?
What exactly is a screw dislocation? Oh, boy. it's one, I guess, in which the... I'm sorry, this is embarrassing. I have to remind myself. But I think it's one in which the orientation of the planes winds around once as I go up the C-axis. This is a sort of very well studied studied subject in metal traditional metallurgy and so forth. I'm afraid I don't have all the details in my head, but I can find you a reference for that. Anyway, the basic picture is that you have these dislocations, and close to the material close to the dislocations in some sense is liquid rather than solid. So in some sense, this is really just extrapolating all the stuff we know about superfluidity in the liquid to the solid, just pretending that bits of the solid are liquid. And if you work hard enough, you can imagine that you have an interconnected network of one-dimensional superfluid channels. That was actually proposed by Shevchenko, that this sort of picture, way back in 1986 or thereabouts, long before there were any experiments in this area. And if you have a sufficient number of super dislocations, people say you can actually get a sort of superglass where you've essentially destroyed the crystalline order completely. And people speculate that essentially that's what happens if you quench too violently. So, for example, you remember there were these experiments in which people quenched very violently and got an apparent superfluid fraction of the order of 20%. So people think this might be this kind of state. In this kind of picture, why would helium-3 have an effect? Well, the usual assumption, of which there is some independent evidence, is that helium-3 does tend to stick. It migrates to the dislocations and then tends to pin them. So so this would then imply, since helium-3 raises the temperature of transition to this supersolid state, that would seem to imply that such pinning is necessary. You need to pin the dislocations before you can get superflow in the core. It's not entirely clear why this should be, but that seems to be the inference. So what are the arguments in favour? Well, if we accept that what's going on is genuine supersolidity, then the other possibility is that it's a bulk solid effect. And as we'll see, there are some rather strong theoretical arguments that you can't get superfluidity in a pure crystal. Okay, we'll come to those later. Second argument in favour is that it does seem consistent with, for example, the liquid-solid-liquid experiments. The extra mass could well have floated along the dislocations, so on. Some arguments are against. First of all, if is higher, this is an experimental fact, that F is higher for single crystals than for polycrystals, which seems the wrong way around because you'd think that polycrystals would like to have far more dislocations. Not clear, entirely clear, that in real life there are going to be enough dislocations to supply the necessary... Yep.
What's a polycrystal opposed to a single crystal?
Oh, it just means an assembly of small micro grains. So you see, if your actual physical sample was composed of a whole lot of these, then you'd certainly get certainly grain boundaries along the edges. You might think you'd also get more dislocations, but it's not entirely clear. This explanation may work for the bulk solid, but it's difficult to see how it worked for helium-4 in Vicor, because Vicor is a system of thin, narrow tubes and so forth. It's just not clear that you get enough screw dislocations and so forth there. So all these arguments are somewhat hand-waving, but anyway. There's been very considerable numerical work in particular on these possibilities, and, well, people have opinions one way or the other. For example, Prokofiev and Svistanov certainly claim strongly that this is enough to explain all the phenomena of supersolidity. Let's now try to give a slightly more general consideration concerning the possibility of genuine supersolidity. If this is what's occurring, what kinds of general constraint can we put on it? And actually, it turns out there's some rather interesting things one can say. Let's consider standard annular geometry, and let's take the thickness of the ring to zero compared with its radius. This just gets rid of a few sort of rather boring and uninteresting effects. The general prescription for doing statistical mechanics, which is, I think, pretty clear-cut, it's in an appendix in Lano Lischitz, if I remember, for doing statistical mechanics in a rotating geometry, that is a geometry where the walls, a situation where the walls are rotating, is that you take your Hamiltonian to be the original Hamiltonian minus this term omega dot L. Let's say that's a fairly standard result. Again, we're going to define, as always, our characteristic quantum unit of rotation here. Now we can actually write down three very general theorems. And these really are, I think, theorems, as we'll see. First of all, in classical physics, in thermal equilibrium, the system is at rest as viewed from the frame of the walls for any value of the angular velocity. It's a somewhat striking and remarkable theorem. No matter how fast or slowly, very obvious limits, certainly for slow enough omega, the system as viewed from the frame of the walls will be at rest. That's not to say it'll necessarily have exactly the same behavior as it was for the walls at rest. For example, if you were not dealing with the special geometry but had a bucket or whatever, then you would get a meniscus fall. Okay, so that is a physical difference. But certainly the liquid would be at rest. That's the neutral analog of the famous Bohr van Leeuwen theorem about atomic diamagnetism. Second theorem, even in quantum physics, in thermal equilibrium, the system is at rest as viewed from the frame of the walls whenever omega is equal to n times omega c, where omega c is this characteristic velocity. That's the neutral analog of the Byers-Yang theorem in superconductivity theory. Finally, and in some sense I think this is the most interesting one in the present context, no state in which the mean angular velocity, by which I simply mean, for this particular geometry, I simply mean the total angular momentum divided by the classical moment of inertia, which is nmr squared, no state in which the mean angular velocity of the system differs from that of the wall by more than omega c over 2 can ever be the thermodynamic equilibrium state. I may or may not give a proof of that later. Now, this actually has a very striking implication. What it means is that not just in the case of solid helium-4, but also even in the case of liquid helium-4, the vast majority of torsional oscillator experiments have never proved probe the true equilibrium behavior. That's even true for the original experiment of Androni Kashvili way back in 1947. Remember, that was the one where we had these oscillating disks. If you look at his numbers and you calculate how fast the walls were rotating, okay, the liquid, allegedly at least the superfluid part of the liquid remained at rest. Okay. Calculate the difference between these, and it's huge, something like 10 to the 4th times omega c. Androni Kashvili never saw the equilibrium behavior. Almost the only experiment which has ever seen the true thermodynamic equilibrium behavior in the liquid is Hess and Fairbank. Very, very few others. Okay, now I do have proofs of these, and I think if we have time, we could perhaps come back and take a look at these, because in some ways the proofs are quite instructive, but yeah.
So for the previous slide, the omega equal to n omega c has some...
Yeah.
I wonder, it only holds for omega c, somewhat like...
Okay, well, perhaps in that case, but we should just go through the derivation, so this will come out. Okay, so let me at least spend a little time for a moment on this derivation then. So first of all, I'll have to derive the result for the classical case. It looks a bit messy, but you'll see the general principle is rather straightforward. In both classical and quantum mechanics, you can divide the Hamiltonian into various bits. The kinetic energy of angular motion, which is going to be the bit we're really going to be interested in, kinetic energy of other motion, the potential of the walls, and the interatomic potential. And incidentally, it is actually rather important here that the interatomic potential be isotropic. That is, it does not depend on the direction of particles relative to one another. That actually is implicit in the argument which follows. So I've written it down here explicitly. Okay. Under rotation, H should be H0 minus omega dot L, and the angular momentum as viewed from the rotating frame is given by this expression here. So this is just transforming into how the angular momentum looks from the rotating frame. Now, proof theorem 1, which is the classical result, in thermal equilibrium, the classical phase-space distribution is given by an expression of this type. And forget about all the other junk here, just concentrate on the dependence on L here. The Hamiltonian is given by a term which is irrelevant here, plus this term here. So exponential minus beta, sum of I, Li squared over mR squared. In thermal equilibrium, under rotation omega with L a continuous variable, H goes to this. The probability distribution is now a function of Li. Remember that since we're doing classical mechanics, Li is a continuous variable here. The Hamiltonian looks like this. Now all we have to do, I suspect that I'm going rather fast. You may not be able to follow the algebra in detail, but yes.
In terms of Li rotation, Li minus mR squared omega, can we look at it as a kind of gauging?
Well, yes. I mean, if you're doing quantum mechanics, you'd be essentially doing a gauge transformation. Since we're, for the moment at least, only doing classical mechanics, we're just transforming to how things look from the rotating frame. It is essentially the same thing. Okay, so now we make this observation that this this extra term which occurred in the Hamiltonian is just the angular momentum as viewed from the rotating frame minus this extra term here. So now the probability distribution as viewed from the rotating frame is just given by this expression. And you see, apart from this final term, which is just a centrifugal term and for finite thickness would give you a meniscus effect, in thermodynamic equilibrium, in classical mechanics, the state of the rotating system as viewed from the frame of the rotating walls is the original state as viewed from the lab. So from the point of view of classical mechanics, the original system and the original frame and the rotating frame are essentially equivalent, apart from this meniscus effect. Okay, now coming to your question, let's go on to the quantum mechanical case. In quantum mechanics, the difference is that L is not now a continuous variable. And so in general, we cannot make this transformation here. L can only take the values nh bar. However, when the rotational velocity of the walls is some integral multiple of this quantum unit of angular velocity, then this shift is simply equivalent to Li goes to Li plus n, where n is an integer. So it is allowed. So we are allowed to make the transformation for this special case, and as you say, it's essentially a gauge transformation that we're making. So you can just repeat the argument, just replacing everything by operators, etc., etc., and you recover the result. Again, in thermodynamic equilibrium, equilibrium this should be, apart from the meniscus, even in quantum mechanics, for these special values of rotational velocity, the state of the rotating system as viewed from the rotating walls is the original state as viewed from the left frame. Okay? Finally, very, very briefly, let's just look at the third theorem. Suppose that the walls are rotating with angular velocity omega, the system is rotating with mean angular velocity, this should be an omega bar here, I guess, and let the free energy be F. What we're going to do is to take our whatever the wave function is, multiply it by this factor here. Now, this factor here is allowable because it is nicely single-valued, and so forth. So we've now got an allowable new wave function, which essentially has just shifted the angular momentum from Li to Li plus h bar. That operation can't affect the potential terms, the transverse kinetic energy, nor the entropy. So the only change is in the angular kinetic energy, and that is given by this expression here. And doing a bit of algebra, you can rewrite this in this form here. And now you stare at that, and you see that if the angular velocity, the mean angular velocity of the liquid, differs from that of the container by more than a half omega c, you can always lower delta F by this operation. So it can't have been the original thermal equilibrium state. Okay? So these really are, I think these are hard theorems, rather generic. Okay, we've already done this one, so let's go on. Yes, okay. Now, what we've seen is that we saw a few slides ago that BEC is certainly a sufficient condition for supersolidity. So now the question is, could we in fact have BEC in a system which is a perfect crystal and therefore has pure crystalline order? Well, first question is BEC kinematically consistent with crystalline order? And the argument is certainly yes, and it's a rather trivial way of seeing this. Imagine that we have some kind of externally imposed periodic potential, say the black lines. Then the non-interacting Bose gas is going to form some kind of zero k block wave state, which just looks like this. Okay. Now imagine that we now switch off the potential. Psi is still a kinematically allowed order parameter. Okay. So there's no kinematic reason why we should not get Bose condensation coexisting with crystalline periodicity. However, is it energetically consistent with crystalline order? And that's a much nastier question. In other words, if we don't have a periodic potential there to enforce the crystalline order, can you get BEC and crystalline order coexisting? Well, for a non-interacting gas in free space, it's fairly trivial to show that it's not possible. In fact, we've essentially done so here. This is a bit of a digression. You can get situations which have nothing to do with bulk supersolid, but where you've got a monolayer or a few layers of helium on top of a crystalline substrate. You can get situations there where it seems at least very plausible that Bose condensation and spontaneous breaking of translation invariance can coexist. I'll just say a very brief word about that, although it's really a topic in its own right. So you've got some underlying crystalline potential. Now, if you simply had superfluidity coexisting with that periodicity, that would not be surprising, and should not be called supersolidity. However, what can happen is, what people think can happen, is that in fact the ad atoms form a monolayer which has a periodicity different from that of the underlying crystal, the so-called four-sevenths phase, in which you have four-sevenths as many at atoms as you have sites, is one case in point. Okay? But that, if you then had superfluidity in that system, that would be a genuine supersolid by conventional definitions. And people do believe that there's a real possibility of that happening. But
so you mean the translational invariance should be broken?
Well, it's not just the translation, the total translation invariance is broken, but even the translation invariance modulo of the original crystalline lattice, you see, is broken here. So the four-sevenths phase which forms has a periodicity different from that of the underlying lattice. So that, I mean, that would be genuine supersolidity, and you can, for example, imagine that you had various defects there. The number of atoms, in this case, the crucial difference is the number of atoms and the number of relevant sites are independently adjustable variables. You can then go back to the original Andreev Lifshitz scenario where you've got a BEC of vacancies and everything, at first sight at least, should work fine. So that may or may not happen in real life, but if it did, it would not be, I think, fantastically surprising. The interesting case, though, is in an interacting Bose system in free space. Could such a system have show simultaneously Bose condensation and crystalline order? The interacting, first of all, you consider the intercommensurate case, which is the original Andreev Lifshitz scenario. In that scenario, remember, you have a number of atoms, a number of sites, which is different from the total number of atoms. And then that means you have a certain non-zero number of vacancies. These vacancies can then undergo Bose condensation, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? And then I think if that were to happen, then most people believe, yes, you would get superfluid behavior. Unfortunately, the energetics of that seem very bad. Just about all microscopic calculations, which people like my colleague David Sepperly, who's a wizard at such things, all these calculations seem to indicate that you simply don't get this situation realized in real life. An even more tricky case is the commensurate case where the number of atoms is equal to the number of sites. Again, kinematically, there's no reason why you shouldn't get Bose condensation occurring. Again, energetically, that seems even more unstable. Incidentally, there is some very strong experimental evidence against the hypothesis of zero-point vacancies, namely that if you look at the temperature dependence of the number of vacancies, which is something you measure experimentally by X-ray scattering, say, then it is exponentially activated with a gap of the order of a few degrees Kelvin. So it looks as if at low temperatures you're going to get very negligible numbers of vacancies occurring. And I'll say this appears to be even worse in that respect from the point of view of the energetics. However, that then raises the $64,000 question. In bulk solid helium 4, it does look, from all these considerations, as if BEC is very unlikely. The $64,000 question is BEC a necessary condition for superfluidity? We've seen that it was a sufficient condition, is it a necessary condition? Well, we know, there's one case in which we know for sure that it's not. That's the Kostelitz-Thallis situation. Two-dimensional films below the Kostelitz-Thallis temperature, you in fact don't technically get BEC, but you certainly do get the system behaving in a superfluid way. However, you can understand that in terms of thermal fluctuations. What about the ground state? In particular, if we write down the standard crystalline ground state and then allow for some overlap, can you get superfluidity? And that, I think, is the really interesting question in this whole field. That's why I've spent a certain amount of time getting to this point. So at this point, let's take a more general approach to NCRI, or if you like, supersolidity. Rather generally, the phenomenon of NCRI is a consequence of the single-valueless boundary condition. In a multiply connected geometry, the many-body wave function must join up with itself consistently. And when the walls are stationary, the consistency condition is that if I take a single atom, take it once around the loop, bring it back to the same position, and with all the other atoms in their original positions, then I must just get, this must be equal to this modulo 2 pi in the phase. Okay. So that's when the walls are at rest. when the walls rotate with an angular velocity, then, again, you can do, in this case, you do explicitly a gauge transformation to your rotating frame. And it turns out now, another way of putting it, it's essentially the same condition as I wrote down before, but in rather different language. What you have to now do is to minimize the original Hamiltonian without the minus omega tilde L term, remember, but with a modified single-valueless boundary condition here. If this should cost an energy proportional to omega squared, then delta E goes as omega squared, then the system will show the Hess-Fairbank effect with a superfluid density proportional to A. That you can derive fairly simply by noticing that the angular momentum is the derivative of the free energy with respect to omega. So, if on every path which connects this to this, the many-body wave function decreases, so the typo here, this speed decreases exponentially, that is, it goes as something like e to the minus the distance you've gone at some point, then you can join up these points to form a hypersurface. You can put in the kink in the many-body wave function at that point with no cost in energy. Therefore, A equals zero and rho s equals zero. So no Hess-Fairbank effect, no non-classical rotational inertia. And you can see that in the blocked capillary case, in the blocked capillary case, you see that's sort of rather obvious because basically your wave functions are decaying exponentially inside here. That's where you can put in the kink. So the multiply connected topology really is essential to the whole phenomenon.
So what is the consequence of this single valueness? Do we have any quantized?
Sure. You see, if we just go back for a moment to the pure annulus, no blockage, and you just consider, say, a free Bose gas, then what the single valueness boundary condition is telling you is nothing more or less than that the single particle wave functions have to be the usual angular momentum eigenfunction, e to the I L theta, with L integral.
Okay, so these two are completely equivalent.
That's the equivalent for a non-interacting gas, but the condition which I've written down is much more general than that. This must apply, however complicated and correlated the wave function is. Therefore, prima facie, the condition for NCRI is that at least on some paths connecting this to this, the many-body wave function should not vanish or become exponentially small at any point. Now, the important point to realize is it's not immediately obvious that that condition can't be fulfilled even in the absence of BEC, and in which case a BEC would not be a necessary condition for superfluidity. Why is this not obvious? Well, here I always make my analogy of buses. Consider a British bus. In a British bus, even usually at rush hour, it is possible for one passenger to get off the bus without the other passengers having to move. Right? Contrast this with, say, a Japanese bus, or probably a Chinese bus, or an Indian bus, I suspect, in which, in a Japanese bus at rush hour, it is possible for one passenger to get off, but only if the other passengers move aside and then move back after him. Right? So the analogy of this is that, crudely speaking, Bose condensation implies that the British bus situation, that is, that a single particle can go all the way around the ring without the other particles having to move. The Japanese bus situation is one where the other atoms have to move aside and then can move back again. And it's not obvious that those conditions are the same. So what we have to try to establish is whether or not there are indeed such paths in our, and whether these are consistent with a crystalline ground state. Now, of course, for the most naive model of a crystalline ground state in which atoms are completely localized to lattice points, it's fairly obvious that can't be the case. Because in that case, there's simply no overlap. You can easily show that you can just take the relevant bit of the wave function and put in the kink at a point where it isn't, so forth. So I think that's fairly straightforward. The real crunch comes when you have to worry about the overlap of these, the fact that in fact, the wave functions of neighboring atoms do overlap. And this is not a trivial effect. We know it's not a trivial effect because in helium-3, which is a Fermi system and has spin, it's this overlap and the resultant exchange of the atoms which is entirely responsible for the magnetic properties. So we do have to worry about the possibility that atoms may be able to change places move around. Now, let's consider a few plausible paths in this crystalline solid. Here's one possible path. You simply take an atom from this point, this lattice site here, and you start moving it past its neighbours. It gets further and further away, and eventually take it round the ring. Now, it's fairly obvious, I think, that once I've got a few lattice spacings from here, what I've essentially done is to create a vacancy interstitial pair, and that is going to have a non-zero energy with respect to the ground state. And as we all know, by the WKB approximation, the wave function is now going to decay exponentially in this way. So by the time you've got once around the ring, it's going to have this factor here, which is essentially zero. Okay. So there'll be no NCRI. So that's possibility number one. Possibility number two is a little more tricky, at least at first sight. We do have to take the Bose symmetry of the many-body wave function seriously, even if we don't think we explicitly we have BEC. That's illustrated rather nicely by this series of experiments on the Mott superfluid transition of an ultra-cold Bose gas in an optical lattice. You start off with a situation in which you think you've got totally localized crystalline light wave function. So the atoms are barely overlapping, and they're certainly not extended throughout the system. You turn your potential down, and lo and behold, the system almost immediately becomes Bose condensed. You can see that from expansion and diffraction measurements. This is quite surprising at first sight, because certainly by the time you actually see experimental evidence for Bose condensation, there's been no time for a single atom to explore the whole lattice. It can only explore its immediate neighbors. So somehow it knew, even though it wasn't originally Bose condensed, it sort of knows to be Bose condensed the moment you change the conditions appropriately. So you do have to take that seriously. So here's the second possibility. We first interchange 1 and 2, then interchange 1 and 3, etc., and take our single atom around the ring in this way. Now, at first sight, at least, you'd say, well, what we've got is that we've moved all these atoms by one, and we've taken this guy around the ring. But because of the Bose symmetry, the first state is the same as simply having taken this guy once around the ring, which must satisfy the modified single-valueless boundary condition. And so if you believed that, you would conclude that the standard crystalline ground state with overlap does have the property of NCRI. Alas, there is a subtlety there. You do have to, since you've moved one atom forward, but you've moved another one back. And when you're calculating the change in the necessary boundary conditions, you do have to worry about that, unfortunately. And so in fact, it turns out that that basically you haven't changed, the boundary conditions don't change at all. And so the phases cancel. This will not give you NCRI. Okay. This is done by Prokofiev and Svistinov in path integral language in the paper. Yes.
Oh, does this exchange cost energy in this case?
Well, it's happening. Let's say it's certainly presumably it's happening in the ground state. How do we know that? Well, we don't directly. There's no direct experimental way of seeing that. But we do know that in helium-3. Similar things do happen in the ground state. And that we know because of the exchange splitting, which gives rise to magnetic properties. I think it's at least a very reasonable point of view that it is happening in helium-4-2 and is a contribution to the ground state energy. It's a small one, but it is a contribution.
So the reason it's changing each other is to become more ground states?
Well, yes. I mean, simply that... here's one way of looking at it. Look at it in the language of the Mott insulator, say. Only we're now talking about bosons, not fermions. So you've got these two atoms sitting on their lattice sides. There is a kinetic energy term in the Hamiltonian which hops this guy to here. Now, of course, when it gets there, it finds it sitting on top of another atom, so it has a very large repulsive energy. So it doesn't want to stay there very long, but it does stay there for a little time. And, of course, in the theory of fermion systems, this is what gives you the antiferromagnetism of your Mott insulator. So presumably something similar can happen in the Bose system. And this is the basis of a conjecture by Phil Anderson, which I'll come to in a moment. Finally, a third possibility is that you start off with one atom, displace it onto its neighbor, But it doesn't, the neighbor doesn't like that, so it hops immediately hops onwards, etc., etc., etc. Again, you go, you can move a single atom all the way around the ring, and this time you haven't had to move anything backwards. So the argument against the last possibility doesn't apply. However, alas, at large distances, it's essentially the same as the first proposal, namely you simply create an interstitial vacancy pair. So again, you've got a pair, you have a fall-off like this. These are three possibilities. Have we exhausted all the possibilities? That's a much nastier question. I should say in this context, a very interesting proposal by Anderson, about a year old now, where he actually proposes, well, I think the presentation is a little confusing in that he emphasizes, and his experimental the experimentalists who believe him have emphasized that he's introducing a large number of vortices. But the point is he really can't introduce the notion of vortex at all unless the system does show the property of NCRI. I don't know why people always think of vortices as fundamental. I mean, vortices are very unfundamental, in my opinion. They're a consequence of more fundamental things like NCRI and so on. Anyway, he claims that even in the pure crystalline solid, you can get, essentially, you can get NCRI. And now it's not clear to me right now, I've come to this fairly recently, it isn't clear to me which of these scenarios, if any, he's envisaging, or whether in fact it's a fourth one, which we haven't yet thought of. I don't follow, right now, at least the argument he gives in his paper. And, as I say, those claim to be, at least one group has claimed experimental evidence in favor of this scenario based on the idea that you get vortices entering and then disappearing, etc., etc. I think the situation right now is frankly rather confused. But I do think this is a really fundamental question. In fact, perhaps the only fundamental question that has been raised by the whole supersolid business is, in a pure crystalline solid, would you expect to get NCRI? In other words, would you expect the topological connectedness of the wave function to have the same kind of effects as it does in a superfluid? And so my guess right now would be no, but that's just my opinion. I think, incidentally, one thing I should say, a lot of people, probably the majority of the community, doesn't believe Anderson. And I think one reason they tend not to believe it is that there have been a lot of fairly conscientious numerical calculations done, which seem to indicate at least that you don't get BEC. I'm not entirely clear that any of the calculations have really excluded superfluidity, which is, as I say, might be a different thing to do. Certainly the numerical people tend to dismiss this possibility. I think there are a huge number of things which one would like to know about the whole supersolid phenomenon, which one doesn't. One thing I would really very much like to know is the following. One very, very important feature, which has been realized from the word go, is the fact that the effect is strongly velocity dependent. That is, it depends on the angular velocity of the walls. If the angular velocity is too fast, then the effect gets destroyed. Why is that? I think there are two obvious main lines of explanation. The first line of explanation simply says that, well, the moment you rotate the system sufficiently fast, you've really, in some sense, created a new kind of state. Therefore, the system just doesn't respond in the same way as it did for zero frequency. The second line of explanation goes something like this. Suppose there is some kind of effective critical velocity. That is, suppose that, for example, the system is behaving much like a superfluid, provided that its velocity relative to the walls is less than a certain upper limit. And suppose thereafter it gets into equilibrium with the walls. Then, given, and we don't know what this critical velocity is a priori, okay, but it could be that the system is essentially behaving in a totally superfluid way for that part of the cycle where the velocity is less than the critical velocity, and it's only for the part of the cycle where you're exceeding the critical velocity where it does anything different. Okay, now I think one ought to be able, as far as I can see, one ought to be able to test that, which of these hypotheses is right, experimentally, simply by looking for harmonics of the original frequency in the response. And interestingly, as far as I know, that hasn't been done. And I've tried to interest a couple of experimental groups in doing that. I think that would be an interesting piece of information. The other thing I would dearly like to know, and this is for a somewhat peculiar reason of my own, is whether magnetic fields make a huge difference. As far as I know, I could be wrong here, but as far as I know, there have been no experiment in which people have tried applying fields of the order of, say, 10 Tesla and seeing if the to a torsional oscillator experiment and seeing if it still works. I would be very, very interested in the result of that experiment. And depending on... Sorry?
If there are neutral atoms.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. That's the whole point, yes. Okay, so what does a magnetic field do to neutral atoms? It does some sort of rather trivial things. For example, if I apply a sufficiently strong magnetic field, the sort of field you get in astrophysics, for example, then what it does is to constrict the atomic orbitals in the plane normal to the field. So it essentially makes the atomic wave function look much more elliptical and so forth. So thereby it would obviously change, for example, the interatomic interaction and so on. So, I meant to look up the numbers on that, but I haven't had time to do it. I did actually do a calculation of that effect long ago in a different context. And I think you have to get fields of the order of a few hundred Tesla before you really have a much chance of seeing those effects. But there is another very amusing thing that can happen, at least in principle. And this I'll give you the example, which is not helium-4, but rather helium-3. Right? Forget about the spins. Obviously the magnetic field interacts with the spins, we know all about that, so throw that away. Right? What about the orbital effects of a magnetic field in helium-3? Okay. First sight, you say, well, the atom's neutral. How can it have any orbital effect? You have two helium-3 atoms forming a Cooper pair. Okay, you can think of this Cooper pair as pretty much like a giant diatomic molecule rotating around one another. Now, question. If I have a diatomic molecule made up of neutral atoms, let's, for example, now think of not of helium-3, but of something like C2, okay? Is there a magnetic moment associated with this rotation? Now you see, if you your first reaction is no, because after all, these atoms are neutral objects. The as long as they maintain their original state, the rotation of the nuclei is exactly cancelled by the rotation of the atoms. That's sort of simple theorem. Okay, now you say, well, wait a minute, that's not quite true. After all, there are van der Waals forces, etc. Turns out they don't make any difference. As long as you only stick to van der Waals forces, again, no magnetic moment. If you think about chemical forces, that is the fact that the electrons actually want to form a chemical bond between these two, then even for the most neutral possible atoms, like say argon or xenon or helium, there is a slight concentration of the electrons towards the center of mass. So they don't entirely cancel the nuclei. Therefore, you should get a magnetic moment. And now, I don't know. One of the things, I'm sure I looked this up years ago when I was doing this in helium-3, but this has to be a known effect in chemical physics. I mean, I'm not sure how important it is. Presumably, if you're trying to measure, say, nuclear magnetic moments with very high precision, it could be an important effect. But anyway, I did the calculation for helium-3, and it's incredibly tiny, basically because the two atoms which form the Cooper pair are only very rarely close enough together for these things to matter. So that immediately gives you a huge weighting down fraction. Also, helium is extremely inert, so these chemical effects are small, but non-zero. And so I made a prediction that you should get approximately 10 to the minus 11 of a Bohr magneton per Cooper pair, and that you might be able to see this in certain kinds of experiment. Way back in the late 70s, after I made this prediction, John Wheatley did this experiment, and he saw a result which was at least consistent with this. I couldn't say it proved it, but it didn't disprove it, so anyway. So it looks like the effect is there, and very recently there have been a couple of different, really independent experiments in Japan, which seem to have given rather strong evidence that qualitatively for the existence of this effect, the so-called gyromagnetic effect. The question, it occurs in helium-3, maybe it occurs in helium-4 too. So what could we get out of that? I think we'd get a lot, in fact. I think actually even a null result of that experiment would be quite valuable. So again, I haven't yet got in touch because I only thought of this very recently, but I'm going to get in touch with some of the experimental groups and can try to.
So if you look at this in terms of that Hess pair bank, if all the molecules kind of align themselves to some reference frame far away, does it mean that, for example, the magnitude moment of these pairs kind of align themselves to some reference so we can have kind of?
Well, the rotation of the the rotation of the helium in the bucket, we believe this is just a theoretical belief, but as I say, it's at least consistent with existing experiments. If you did this experiment at the North Pole, then what you'd find is that the helium appears to, the bucket may be rotating at some arbitrary velocity, pretty much. The helium will appear to be rotating once a day in the frame of the fixed, once a day in the Earth's frame, i.e. it's stationary in the frame of the fixed stars. So
that doesn't mean kind of rotational invariance is broken. So if we can polarize the atoms in the setup itself, we can always have a kind of preferred axis for it.
Well, I mean, in some sense, you would be getting maximum rotational invariance in this state because the as viewed from the cosmic reference frame, your liquid would simply be stationary. Now, of course, you could create a metastable state in which it was circulating, say, circulating with this characteristic angular moment velocity, and that would then, what would you say then? That would be fixed by the orientation of the bucket. You see. So that'd be a much more local effect. But I think it would be rather, it'd be nice to see this effect because it would be rather direct evidence that, as it were, quantum mechanics does know about cosmology, or at least respects the Marx principle. Okay, so I think we've, are there any general questions, comments? Yeah.
I was wondering if there are any analogies for maybe like P-wave superconductivity in this superfluid picture?
I think if you want to think about P-wave superconductivity, you probably shouldn't be thinking about something like helium-4 because helium-4 is a Bose system, and generally speaking, at least in the liquid, we believe that the Bose condensation which occurs is Bose condensation of the simple atoms themselves. So it's one particle, it's the one particle level. In a superconductor, the condensation is at the two particle level. And when one talks about, say, P-wave versus S-wave, one's talking about the relative structure of the Cooper pairs, which are condensing. So the people have speculated occasionally on the possibility of having two-particle condensation in a Bose system, but I think all the odds are that's going to be energy without having one-particle condensation. And I think that all the odds are that's going to be very unfavorable energetically. But if you want something which is, as it were, P-wave and closer to this, then of course you do have superfluid helium-3. It's believed that that is a P-wave Fermi superfluid. Okay, so maybe we should stop here. And next time I'm going to talk about something different, which is the exotic superconductors and what they do and don't have in common. I spend most of the time actually describing the various classes of exotic superconductor and then try to pull them together at the end of the lecture.